Hey everyone, welcome to Write On, the podcast from Final Draft. This is a show where we talk about all things screenwriting. I'm your host, Sharday Sellers. On today's episode, we have an interview with the hilarious screenwriting team of Lionsgate's latest movie, Joyride, Teresa Hsiao and Chevapravatdumrong. Teresa, Cherry, and I chat about writing on spec, the power of female friendship, and the benefits of a throuple, plus more. Check it out.
All right, hello. How are you today, Teresa and Cherry?
Good. How are you?
I'm doing really well. I just want to start by saying I loved your film. I'm sure you've heard that 1,000 times. I got
We'll take it. We're the writers. We need the compliments.
Yeah.
The compliments fuel us, or else we'll spiral.
We're never going to make it through this interview if you didn't start off that way. So, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, I saw it with my best friend, and we just held each other's hands and like laughed and then cried together. So it was really, really, really fun. Okay, so I'm from Final Draft, so this is going to be mostly about the script, which is going to be a little different, I think, than some of your other interviews today.
Yeah.
So I want to ask, because I read about how the project came together, but I wanted to know how, if you knew, you two knew each other beforehand, or if you started this project brand new, and then how that relationship worked writing together.
We did know each other beforehand for years, by the way, before we started.
Hands?
Oh, should we hold hands?
Okay.
Oh my God, my hands are really cold, by the way.
They're so cold.
I'm sorry. I touched her hand. It was really warm. And I was like, oh, sorry. I just scared her. We worked on Family Guy before this. That was how we met. We basically had been friends for years and years and had also worked together for years and years before doing this. We were well-versed in being collaborative and working together. So when we started writing this spec, it was very natural. It was just like, oh my God, this big, huge TV room you used to work in, now it's two people. Do it. And we did.
It's so cool. It's like the dream job to work with your friend and just write jokes that you would tell each other in private on a page for people to see.
Exactly. It was super. That's exactly what we were doing. We're just like, let's try and make each other laugh. And then we'll see what happens with it later. And
yeah, we were never expecting it to actually get made. We were just like, we're going to write this dumb thing together and it's going to be just for us. And then all of a sudden people were like, oh, we like it and we want to make it. And we're like, what?
How'd that happen? This was a spec script. What? How did that happen?
Which is so super rare. So for our listeners who are also aspiring writers, can you talk about the process of writing on spec and what that was to get people to read it?
So the process of writing on spec, I guess we broke the story with our other friend Adele, who directed the movie, and it was just the three of us just coming up with these characters, coming up with scenarios that would make us laugh. And then Teresa and I worked together in this. We basically, once we had the story outline, we divided up scenes and we each took scenes separately, and then we would just trade them and then read them. And then once we had notes on each other's scenes, we finally then sat down together or used Final Draft collab mode.
We love Final Draft collab mode.
Final Draft collab mode saved our lives.
It truly saved our lives.
You know what I mean? Sometimes you don't want to drive to the other person's house.
Yes.
And so you can just do it on Final Draft collab. Thank you. But basically, once we got to that stage, we were really, really in it working together the entire time.
Yeah. Now, listeners, I did not put them up to this. I promise you, they were not paid to say that. That was an organic testimony.
Yeah.
So
yes, we have probably initiated at least like 1,000 Final Draft collabs together.
Yeah. Yeah.
Over the course
very
of the
familiar
process.
With it. And by the way, then took that and have taught other people how to use it, like on other TV jobs that I've had after this. You know,
nice.
It's like, oh, you want to do collab? And they're like, what? And I'm like, let me show you what you have to click. And then again, we can work on this from long distance.
It really is amazing. And speaking of collaborations, Teresa, I heard you were from Michigan. I read. I didn't hear.
That's me. This one's from Boston.
Yeah.
So, East Coast.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm the Midwest.
Oh, sorry.
I'm the nice girl from the Midwest, and she's the scary Boston person.
What the fuck?
Oh, my God, I'm so scared.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, she's going to kick my ass right now. So, yeah.
Wait, but I'm from Michigan. I'm from Lansing.
Oh, my God, stop. Yay, Ann Arbor.
Yeah.
Oh, we love.
Yep.
Yeah, she's so. And Teresa's very bored right now, but we love
Michigan.
It.
Michigan, whatever.
We love Michigan. Listen, Ashley and Sabrina, who are in the movie, are also from Ann Arbor, which is insane.
Yes.
So, you know what I mean?
And that's why I brought it up, because the character of Audrey was eerily similar to my experience growing up in Michigan.
Yep, there you
so
go.
So I wanted to know if that's where it came from, just the idea of being a minority or person of color, but being raised around a lot of white people and then adapting that culture and then your culture going, who are you? And you're like, I don't know. That was very relatable as exactly. a girl who grew up in Michigan.
Oh my God, yay. Well, that actually came from both of our experiences because Teresa's town also was, you know, were you grew up with one other Asian?
Yes, yeah, so I had one other Asian girl in elementary school growing up. And so we just sort of like locked eyes. We immediately became friends. And her name was Lisa, which meant we had rhyming names. So it's like people got us mixed up because we were Asian and we had rhyming names. I mean, it kind of makes more sense because of the rhyming names. But I always kind of think about like, oh, would we have been friends had we not just been Asian and growing up in this like predominantly white town? And I'm like, I don't know. I think so. I want to think yes. But it's also just like, it's just funny that they like we just connected with each other so quickly right away because of that experience. So.
And it wasn't just our childhoods, by the way, because taking it back to Family Guy, we were the only two women and the only two Asian people in a sea full of white guys in the room. So definitely it was very much like, you, let's hold hands.
Hold hands.
Which
hold
we
hands.
Will not because my hands are very cold.
So cold.
I might have health problems. We're yeah, not sure.
I'm worried.
We're worried. Am I going to make it? I might. If I pass out, we'll know why that happened. But basically.
Yeah, this is the last day yes, that Carrie's on Earth. So
like I'm going to pass away. But that's the thing. It's like, it's something that coming up in this industry, by the way, is something that happened. You know what I mean? It was like, oh, childhood all over again in many ways. So we were drawing from lots of areas of our lives when we were writing those characters.
And what I love about this film especially is, obviously, I'm not Asian, but there's a character for every friend in this movie. Ironically, I'm all four or three.
Oh, yeah.
Different parts of me. I was like, yeah, I could do Yeah, that's me. I want to know for each of you which character you feel like is more similar to your personalities.
I'm Deadeye.
It's always so funny how quickly you're like, I'm Deadeye.
I'm Deadeye. Yes. Yeah. Well, here's the thing though. We were just talking, say who you are first and then I'm going to say the other
Well,
thing
okay, so I know what you're going to say. Yeah, I think I know what you're going to say, but I feel like I was Lolo, an aspiring Lolo, but we, in the process of making this movie, writing it, not only writing it, but also producing it, we realized that, you know, obviously doing all this stuff, we basically are Audrey as well because we had to be so fucking responsible the whole time. We're like always in a Google Doc. We're always in a Google spreadsheet.
We're always just doing the most and working as hard as we possibly can because it is extremely difficult, turns out, to make a movie, not only to write it, but to also produce it. So we were just, Audrey billed like 3,000 hours a year, and
we build a lot of hours.
We build a lot of hours. If we were lawyers, yeah. So we're also
Audrey. Theoretically, I'm definitely probably more of an Audrey, but I aspire to be Lolo. Is the thing.
You know what? I aspire to be Audrey.
Oh my god! What are you?
Well, the thing is, Audrey's get things done. Like that's the thing.
Yes.
They set a goal and they go after it, and like that's what we did. Like,
and they also get to have a little.
We made
fun.
It. Right. You saw.
Yeah. You saw.
Yeah. Well, I mean, well, honestly, okay. We all aspire? Probably.
No, that's a great. No, and that's exactly. I'm trying not to give away spoilers because I'm not quite sure when this will air. But I will say there is a amazing thruffle scene that opened my eyes to possibility of a world I never knew was possible.
Yeah,
for
think
female
about it.
Pleasure.
Yes.
But for female pleasure, and that's why the scene was so different. Because when you think of a thruffle like that, you think, oh, it's about the men, but then you're like, oh wait, women can, it could be about the woman. And for her, that was mind blowing.
That was, that's exactly what we were going for. We were like, this is Audrey's idea. Audrey wanted to make this happen. You know what I mean? She's like, guys,
we did have a producer who asked us, a male producer who's like, is that even possible? We're like, and you know, two heads are better than one.
Yeah.
So, you know, two writers better than one.
Yeah. Those guys in the movie, they did a nice collab. So
they did a collab did a collab.
Yes, not on Final Draft, on something else.
There was a lot of collaboration on the film people.
Yes,
that's what
guys.
We'll say collaboration.
Collab.
I like
group
that as
project.
The, I like that as the, you know, code word.
There's a project. I do want to ask, speaking of Deadeye, you mentioned, Cherry, that you closely connected to them. Where did you find that actor? Because I have never fallen in love with someone as quickly as I did at the moment they stepped on screen.
Same.
Which, by the way, to nerd out a little bit, that That reversal of you think this is going to be Deadline.
And oh my God. Yeah.
So brilliant. It had me dying laughing. It was amazing.
Oh my God. Credit to Josh Fagan, one of our producers. I think he pitched the fake Deadeye.
Yes.
Yeah.
Hilarious.
That was an awesome fake out. Credit to our amazing casting director, Rich D'Elia. He said, oh, there's a comic out of New York that you guys should see. And we had kind of vaguely known about Sabrina before because they had been a staff writer on one of our friend shows, but we had never seen them perform. And then they sent in that tape and it was immediately fell in love.
It was like I wanted to protect them and hug them
protect
so
them
bad.
At all costs.
Literally
protect
them. That was
a mantra on set, was protect Sabrina at all costs.
Yeah.
And also fame change Sabrina.
Yes, that was our inside joke. Literally while we were fame change Sabrina.
Which of course fame did not change Sabrina at
yes.
all. But even though they're just so incredible. And the movie actually ended up kind of being like their talent show because especially in, I guess no spoilers, but there are moments where they really got to shine in so many different ways of like, oh, you can dance, you can act, you can write,
yes.
you can beatbox, you can play basketball. There are too many things. It's too many talents in one person. It's depressing.
They have an amazing singing voice. Like there was one joke at one point where they had to sing something like opera. And they just busted it out like this incredible high note. And it was like, oh my, okay, so that, you can do that too. Great.
Yeah.
You know, didn't make the movie, but it happened. And we were all like, what?
But as writers, because I, you know, this is a writing podcast and I'm a writer as well. How gratifying does it feel to have a joke on the page or have an idea of a character and then just see someone just nail it? And you're like, it wasn't in my mind. It actually works.
I think that's so much of a credit to our incredible actors because there were things that were on the page that were just straight lines. And they said them in ways that were so funny that we're like, wow, it's incredible how funny this is. And I think as writers, you know, obviously coming from TV, you just get to the point where you do have to pivot sometimes. You have to switch around mm-hmm. in terms of like, oh, your actors can do these things really well. And there are things that you write on the page that you think are going to be really funny. And just they're like, it's not going to be funny. And so we were constantly writing because we were there on set the whole time. We were always writing. We were writing at night. We were writing on the weekends. Like we did not stop writing until basically like the second to last day. We were like, are we done?
We stopped 2 seconds
done?
Ago. We're Audrey. We got in our hours.
Yeah,
exactly.
We wrote after the movie. No, I'm just kidding.
We're on strike. We're not writing
right
now.
We're not writing
right
now.
Can't do it.
I don't even know how to write anymore.
Yeah, forget it.
Don't
we haven't. Sorry. We have not opened Final Draft in a long time.
Yes.
It's been a minute. Yeah.
Cherry, I want to know the process of jokes for both of you. How do you know what's funny? Especially because now you've got Seth Rogen and his team as well in this. So it's like, what is the process of coming from Family Guy, especially in TV, of pitching jokes, knowing what is going to work, what's not going to work? Like, how does that happen?
Well, that's the thing is like, there's so many stages at which you think something might work, but then maybe it doesn't work. And then you end up pivoting to something else instead from Family Guy, from working on TV, and also from working on this movie, because with Seth and Evan and our producers, Josh and James, and our on-set writers, Jess and Nina, it kind of functioned as a mini TV room. Like we could pitch something out loud or write something. And if the other people laugh, great. And then the actor can say it. And if people still laugh on set, that's great. But honestly, that's why we wanted to have a lot of different alts like we did on Family Guy for different spots, because you never know what's going to actually end up working in front of the audience. Like in the editing process, we would plug in what we thought, you know, so we think this is the strongest joke, let's do it. And then in our test screening, sometimes that didn't work. And we were very lucky that we had tons of other jokes that we could just keep plugging things in to see what works the best. Because sometimes you know, and it's very, very funny on set. And sometimes that's the thing that works. But sometimes, you know, you cracked each other up on set, maybe because no one got any sleep for 2 months. And then a general audience does not think it's as funny as you did. But it was great because for any given moment where that happened, we had something else waiting on deck.
Yeah, and I think what you learn from being in a TV writer's room is that, like, the currency is laughter. So it's like anytime on Family Guy that you get sent off to a joke room, you come back, you pitch your jokes in the room, and depending on the laughter in the room, that's the joke that goes into the script. Like, the funniest joke in the room goes into the script.
Makes sense.
And so it's always just sort of like a barometer. We're like that weird, like, CNN election tracker where we're just like, was it a funny joke? Did people laugh? If they didn't laugh, then you got to replace the joke. And so in our test screenings, it's always just about, like, what got the biggest laugh? And basically, like, trying to beat it every single time. Do we have more jokes here in this area if it didn't get a good laugh? And if it didn't get a good laugh, is there a way to cut it? So always, and especially with, you know, these kinds of comedies, it's always, like, it's all about the laugh. And then there are, of course, in the movie, there are moments where you're like, we're not even looking for a laugh at this moment. And we're just kind of live in this kind of, like, quieter, more emotional point. But, yeah, we're we're, you know, comedy suckers for laughs.
Yeah. Comedy-wise, we are very, very used to the process of, like, try it. If it doesn't work, no ego about it. Just try something else. It's not a big deal. Like, TV comedy like, training gives you that.
Is it right to say, because it feels like what you're explaining is like, it's like chemistry. It's like a little O2, a little H2O or whatever. I'm not a chemist. I don't know.
No, guys, clearly. We don't listen, like, but we aren't either. Oh, we would have believed you. Like, I'm just like, that sounds right.
Yeah. No, it sounded wrong to me. I'm kidding. I'm an Audrey. No, I was like, that's not right science.
Yeah, it is. No, but it is chemistry. It is the very, it's the fact that the actors all had great chemistry and we all became friends with them. And we were, it was just so much fun just trying to make each other laugh on set every day. And that, yeah, that really bred some things that just came out of nowhere. There's so many jokes in the movie that just came out of like, even maybe not even a specific joke that someone wrote, but maybe you have a germ of an idea and then somebody else changed it and somebody else pitched on that. And then the actors just took it and ran with it. And I feel like, yeah, that's definitely something that comes out of like chemistry between a bunch of people who trust each other.
Yeah, I think
I have a favorite joke and I wanted to know where it came from.
Yeah.
I'm not gonna give the joke away, people, but it's the Harry Potter joke.
Oh, that's literally an example of what,
yes,
of what I just said. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, I think part of, again, being part of a sort of TV writer's room is that oftentimes, you know, you have a joke on the page and you're like, okay, this is great. That was definitely a joke that I don't even think was written. It was not written on the page. It was, there was an idea. And I think Sherry basically just kind of said, hey, I have this idea based on an alt that we had. And they just kind of ran with it because again, so much credit to the actors of being really, really funny. And for us, it's like, of course, if you can beat our joke, always beat it. You're just doing a better job. And so we want to put you in a position where you feel comfortable enough to be like, hey, I've got an idea. And, you know, they're professional comedians. They're professional, funny people. And so that joke was definitely something that was not written that they just came up
amazing
with.
And that dead-eye delivery was just, when I tell you, I was gasping for air. It's like, this is my millennial, this is peak millennial comedy for me. A good Harry Potter joke. Amazing. I mean, I could gush about it all day long. I want to ask, first of all, I want to call out, the listeners can't see you, but I can. Did we match to the title?
We just noticed. It's not there.
It's not there. No, but when we were seeing ourselves before, we literally just noticed just now. Like, we've been bopping around for like a couple hours this morning already, but we didn't until we were
like,
sitting.
I was like, can someone take a screenshot
and
of
it was
this?
Between
it's not
us.
Behind us.
Fully, no, we
like,
didn't.
Like, in the room.
No, not on purpose, but did it work? Marketing?
No, it worked. And I, you know, women, I'm like, women are so brilliant. They match the font titles of their movie. Just
I know.
We're so on brand. Okay, we're ready. We made this thing. We're ready to sell this thing. Yeah, no.
We said how show I was all like, the time so kind of matching. Producers.
We guys, yeah. No, it completely unintentional, but yeah, we've done this before.
Well, like, you know, as a writer, we don't often get to be in front of the camera or like look hot or do things like this. And so we need to like take it. We're like, that's why we're like clutching ourselves. We get to do these things. We get to mash a sign. Like, what the fuck?
This is amazing. Wow. It's crazy.
I just thought it was fun. I was like, they're so smart.
We will take the credit, but it's not deserved. We did not do this on purpose. Yeah.
I want to talk about, because to me, the best signature of a movie is a good emotional through line. I talk about that all the time in the podcast. It's like, you can't just have jokes. You can't just have horror. We need an emotional connection. And this emotional connection, Audrey seeking her birth mother, was so gripping. I want to know how that storyline came to be.
It was always something that we had thought about of, you know, it's funny because when you sort of say like of the writing process, rewriting process, we always had this emotional through line. We always knew it was going to go in this sort of way, that there was going to be a sort of a moment of realization and then also of really wanting to find this person by the end. And that the emotional through line stayed the same. Like a lot of the set pieces ended up changing as we were writing and rewriting, but this emotional through line really made it all the way through. And I think it kind of comes from like when we were talking about the story of just like, okay, especially people in our community, a lot of times it was all about like, we want to fit in. It's all about assimilation. We want to feel as part of the community. And then allowing yourself to be like, you know what? Actually, I want to do these things on my own. I don't really care about sort of what other people think of me. And I think for Audrey and her journey throughout this, obviously the birth mom journey is part of that, but it's almost a little proxy of her finding herself. And so I do think it's so nice to hear you say of like all the jokes and things like that only really work because you're emotionally connected to these characters. And it really comes from, I think, a personal place of like, even though we you know, we're not adopted. It's like we've had this journey, this identity sort of journey as ourselves, and really wanting to tell that story through Audrey.
Which is, it's such a key word that you just said, obviously, because you wrote it. Identity, which is a huge theme here. Everyone in this film is searching for, like, who am I? What do I like? What do I, what don't I like? I mean, that's why we get some really fun experimental scenes.
collabs.
Yes.
Collaboration.
Yeah.
On a lighter note, switching from the emotional side, was Cardi B's song your first choice in the script?
Once it came down to, the thing is we had, I mean, realistically, what can you clear? You know what I mean? Like, what's in the budget?
Right, right.
What are, like, honestly, and coming from TV, we were very well acquainted. Like, we, you know, having to deal with production before, we're well acquainted with sometimes you don't always get the song that you want. But so we, it was kind of just like, oh, a placeholder in our heads for a long time. It's like, we know they're going to K-popify some song. But then, I want to say it was pretty late in production that we finally, like, landed on it. And then it was like, oh, it has to be that. Please let them clear it, because it's gonna have to be that. It was perfect because the song's awesome. But then thematically, you know, it's about empowerment. It's about, like, owning it. It really worked well for that too.
Cardi B, do you know if she's seen it? I feel like that
Listen,
we would love for
prayers.
Her to see it because yes.
I mean,
we hope we did her proud.
Yes, please.
Without giving this away, I'm gonna phrase this next one and you're gonna laugh because the way I'm trying to phrase it. On the page, how does one write interior?
Yep.
Oh, you sure. Yeah, yeah,
you know,
yeah. Okay, how do we get around not spoiling?
Right.
I think it was actually just an action line, to be honest.
We didn't
fully live there.
You didn't.
It wasn't
it
a
out.
Scene. It wasn't a scene heading. It was not a new slug. No. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, and that's all we'll say about that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I was like, this is great. I want to know on the page how it happens. Wrapping up towards the end here, you said you were writing all the way start and finish.
Yeah.
And then the editing happens and you said you still have to slot things in.
Yep.
So from what you wrote to beginning to what the final product is, how much has changed? How much hasn't changed? And what do you think you're really proud that maintained throughout?
That opening scene with the little girls was the same all the way through, which, you know, that right. packs a wallop both emotionally and just humor-wise. That's great. As Teresa mentioned, sort of the Audrey journey, that whole storyline, all the huge linchpins of what the story was going to be stayed the same throughout. And then what happened, because it's comedy and it's production on a budget, is the set pieces and a lot of the jokes changed. But we always knew there was going to be a K-pop scene. We always knew there was going to be a basketball team.
Doing something.
Yeah. So yeah, those a lot of the big sort of signposts along the way stayed the same.
Have you been able to watch the film, the current film, where it's at with an audience?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. We've watched it with a couple of different audiences, and it's so fun to watch it with people who have never seen it for the first time, because we've been living in it. We've seen the movie like probably 1,000 times, and, you know, like actually seeing it with people, with other people who haven't seen it before, has always been really fun, because there are moments where we loved even just watching the audience watch it. Like at this point, you know, our parents are going to see it tonight.
That's what I was going to ask. Has your family
seen it? Oh, yeah. By tomorrow at this time, that will have changed.
Cherry will be dead, of course, because of her circulation issue.
Yes, exactly. But, or because my parents will have killed me. Who's to say? We don't know.
Well, yeah, Michiganders aren't quite there yet.
They have been warned that it's very R-rated.
Okay.
But again, you know, there's a lot of R-rated movies out there, and not all of them necessarily have some of the things that you see in our movie, so... This is going to be new. It's going to be a new experience for our parents.
Which is a good commentary. I want, because, you know, Seth Rogen, obviously, and Evan, they're always known for making these male, like, comedies, and we love them. But this is, quintessentially, this is a really great them and female comedy. And what I love about it, and I was wondering if this was a fear in your mind, is that I was in my screening, men were there, straight men. They were laughing their ass off. Women. Queer women. Someone brought a baby, and for a moment
cool,
it starts
okay.
crying. And I think we all kind of yelled at the baby, but because we were just like, we want to watch the movie. Please do this somewhere else. But he shut up. So I just wanted to know, when you're developing something like this, are you even having those conversations like, well, we hope men like it, or we hope women who aren't Asian like it? Like, what does that feel like as a writer?
I think because we wrote this on spec, And again, we weren't writing it thinking that it was going to get made. We were really just writing it for ourselves. And so there was no point where we were like, oh, we need to think about the realities of like which demo was going to enjoy this the most. I do think that, like, obviously to your point, it's like once we started making it and we were in editing, there were definitely conversations where we were like, oh, is this joke going to be too specific? But at the same time, I think the lucky thing was, especially with Point Grey and with Lionsgate, they were really open to us saying, like, listen, we know this joke is like maybe a 10%er and only 10% of the people are going to get it, but we really feel strongly about it. And I think a lot of times, like, those kinds of jokes somehow land, even if you don't get it, even if you're not one of the people who gets it, like, other people are like dying and like laughing so hard that it just like infuses comedy everywhere.
Yeah.
It wasn't ever something that we were like, we need to adjust the script in any way to sort of fit the demos.
Which is really great to hear. I mean, because comedy, funny is funny at the end of the day. But there were like some cultural stuff that I didn't quite understand. But seeing my friend, she's of Asian descent, dying laughing, I was like, oh, this is so great to know that you get this.
Yeah,
and this is
like,
really a connecting to you. Even though if I'm like, it's funny, I'm not getting it as much as you are. Yeah. But it is really funny. And it's really nice to see her just be like,
it can be so nice. Yeah. Yeah. To
see. She felt very seen.
Totally. Like one strong, like it's, even if it's just one or two very strong reactions, that's something that anyone else, and that's why it's nice to see it in a theater with a bunch of people, is that you can hear that even if you didn't quite get it and take that in and know that moment was a moment for someone.
And this is
when,
like,
I tell you, people were crying in our theater.
Oh, like,
good.
Not just from laughing, but it was really great to see people just go, oh my gosh, I'm so happy to see myself on screen. It was nice.
There was, go ahead.
Oh no, I was just gonna say, like, I think the nice thing too is like, in just not really getting the joke, but then having your friend be like explaining this to you, like the lofty element of this is like, oh, cultural learning of like, oh, you just learn things about different cultures. You're like, oh, I didn't know that you guys did that. Or I didn't know that that was a funny thing. Like, I think that's the sort of secret message too, of just like, oh, in representation, obviously, you know, being able to see people that you don't really like, that you see these communities that you haven't seen before, and then also learn about their cultures and be like, oh, wow, that was a weird, funny thing that you guys did. Like, that's part of what's so exciting about this too.
Yeah. And that was our conversation at dinner afterwards. I was like, explain that joke to me. And so it was really great to learn, because, you know, you don't really ask your friends those questions.
Yeah. Like, how else would
But
you...
it was a conversation starter.
But it was a conversation starter.
And it doesn't
Although
even...
I will say,
oh, yeah, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, the joke that I think it was Deadeye makes about your hands behind your back and walking around the neighborhood.
Oh my God.
I got that one. Yeah. And I was like, this is great.
Oh my God. Thank you, Kreisha, who worked on the movie, like her pitch. It made all of us feel seen.
Our producer's assistant pitched that joke.
Yeah.
And she was so great.
It was so great. It made us all feel seen. And that's the thing. It's like, things that are so specific don't even have to be like culturally specific, because there was one screening where like the Lin-Manuel Miranda thing, some guy died. Like, he laughed so, it was like one person, and we were like, okay, great. Whoever that was, you know, Broadway fan, whoever you are, great, great.
Right. And so a joke for everyone. Yeah, the Broadway fans alike. So as I'm wrapping up, I'm time here. I want to ask each of you, it's something we ask everyone on the podcast, and it's, what advice do you have for your younger writer self? So I'll start with you, Teresa.
I think my advice would be that you don't need to always be writing. And I think a lot of times writers give the advice of like, oh, always be writing, always, you know, like, keep on working on your scripts, persist or whatever. And I'm like, no, sometimes it's good just to be like, you know what, I'm going to take the day, take a week for myself, go live life, go meet people, go talk to people, because I think that's where sort of the fun ideas come from. And you should give yourself permission to not write in order to become a better writer.
Love that. Thank you so much for saying that.
And I would say, and this is, it's not the opposite, because it is kind of, this can be a long game. I mean, it is a long game. Hopefully it's a long career for everyone. But, you know, the reality is that it sometimes can take a very long time to break in. And, you know, I would just, like, the advice would be to just, like, stick in there. You know, like, I know people who it took, like, well over 10 years, you know, as an assistant, sort of doing the thing, doing other things, coming up before they actually got their first writing job. But the difference is they're the ones who stuck in and eventually got that job. I mean, all power to people who are like, you know what, this maybe isn't for me, and they decide to do something else. But I would just encourage anyone who really, really knows that they want to do this to, like, stick in. You never know when it's going to happen, but it won't if you leave. So please stay and keep doing the thing. But don't spend all your time writing. Go live your life.
Yes. Go have a thruple.
Have yes. a couple and then write a spec script about it.
And write a spec script. Yeah. Thank you so much, Cherry, Teresa. Again, Joyride is a joy and it is a ride and it is so funny and poignant and I'm going to see it again.
Yes.
Because right. I want to actually just hear all the audience laugh. And you know, sometimes they laugh over the joke, so you got to go back.
You got to go back, please. Yes, spend please. More money, please.
So, I definitely will. Thank you so much for having me. Please come back on the show for the next one, Joyride 2.
Oh my God. Yeah. Oh my God, yes. Thank you.
Manifested into existence.
Yes.
Exactly. Thank you both.
Thanks.
Thanks again to Teresa and Cherry for coming on the show. Joyride is now in theaters everywhere.
And as always, thanks to you, our listeners. If you like this episode, leave us a review. And if you haven't already, subscribe to our show on Apple, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts. For news about new episodes and more, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter at Final Draft Inc., and on Instagram at Final Draft Screenwriting.
This podcast is produced by Final Draft and Sharday Sellers.
Editing is by Sean Bonnet. Music by T. Kelly. Thanks again, everyone. Until next time, write on.